all of a sudden, I... It was like the thing just collapsed on me and I couldn't breathe. And so, yeah, somewhere along the line I have developed claustrophobia.
Oh, no.
So we only got part of it done. Either that or send me over to St. Luke's for the open one.
Where was this done at?
Right in Ascension. Right in the MRI department. And I hadn't had a problem before, you know. And I was laying in there, and it was just kind of all of a sudden, you know, because I could tilt my head and look out. I mean, I was only about that far from the back part of it, so I could look out and be fine, but... Yeah, all of a sudden it's just like everything just was like, and I started squeezing that ball.
Mom,
she's
let herself tea already.
Mom, she's got another one.
I told her too late. Since it's like, I don't know
what they're going to eat. Is it keener? Yeah, kind of, but I mean, it's just kind of. Forget what the, just even with the little bit of results that we got, I think there was two discs that were having issues going on right now, but my L5S1 is like almost not even there. It's almost bone on bone. So there's that, and then I got thinning in the L4, L5, the L3, L4, and the L2, L3. It's two of them, I think, have bulges or hernias or something that it's. But, I don't know, then I went and had a consult with a chiropractor. And she's like, yeah, I've helped people like that with those issues, you know, lots, and blah, blah, blah. And I had two visits with her, and not a thing happened. So I'm like, you know what? I'm not even going.
You don't know until you try it. It's different.
Well, I'm not. Like I was, I got tangled up in my bed one morning, and I was kind of in a position like I would do my stretching, and I was trying to get up, and all of a sudden my back just went crack. And since then, my pain level has gone from here to here. So that's why I thought maybe I'd go to a chiropractor. Now with that going on, I just figure I'm gonna.
Oh, yeah. those who are still in the back. Welcome to those of you who join us online on this sunny Sunday morning. Sunny. Winter is snowy, I suppose. I'm sure there are some announcements. I think what I have for you this morning is next week is our first Sunday in Advent. This week, though, is our last Sunday in the liturgical church year. So our Gospel of Luke that we've been walking through for a whole year, this is our last week in Luke, and we get the privilege and the joy of reading right into the center of the Gospel today. So it's Christ the King Sunday, that's why we're wearing white, and sometimes called Reign of Christ Sunday. It's good to be together. Next week we'll start Advent, and so that means a week from this Wednesday, so in a week and a half, we'll begin some Advent worship services. Our first one will be a special one, and that is kind of a worship and serve night for young people and older folks. So we're especially inviting our youth, but also anyone who would like to join us Wednesday night in a week and a half. I think that would be the 30th, at 6 o'clock that's going to be at 3:45. At 3:45 for service, packing some kits for IFC, and a brief time of prayer and worship. Then for the rest of Advent, we'll have services, and I can officially announce this now, they will be at 3:45, so kids can come right after school, and you can also get home before it's dark if you would like to join us for Advent services. So services at 3:45 will be fairly informal and short, and a good time to be together. I think that's all I have for you. What are the announcements do you have?
Okay, so the bazaar is coming up. There's sign-up sheets in the back. We need lots of help, so if anybody can come in, take a look. The other thing is, next to new items can start coming in next week. Monday, tomorrow, we're having a meeting just to kind of discuss everything, to see where we're at, if we're going to have to cut back. If we don't have enough help, we might have to cut back on items. And so whatever you can do.
Yeah, Renee, when is the bazaar?
Oh, look at that. December 3rd is our bazaar. And any other questions?
What time is the meeting tomorrow night?
5:30. 5:30, and so if you have questions, you know, talk to myself, talk to Mary, talk to Lynn. There's also the raffle tickets that Joanne or Joanne Gustafson, Jean Johnson will have, and selling, and so if people can get those out, that's always a great help. So. Thank you.
This is for helpers for the worship service on Sunday. And we're just kind of wondering who would be willing to help in the various areas. And there's a basket back in at the fellowship hall that you can just set these in when you leave today. If you didn't get one of these, I have more. So just let me know and I'll give you one. We appreciate everybody being willing to help with that so the service goes a little smoother. Thank you.
Thanks, Linda. Even if you don't think there's anything on there you might be interested in, grab it, take a look, and if you don't like them all, you can write no on the whole thing. That's just fine. Lynn?
Okay. Good morning. We're going to have a special congregational meeting on Sunday, December 11th, immediately following worship service. back in September, I had announced we were going to do this, and then after I read the constitutional farther, I found out that if you're making a recommendation to change your constitution, you can't actually bring it to the congregation for a minimum of 60 days after the council approved it. So that's why it's coming back up again. So the purpose of this special congregation meeting is to vote on the two following items. The first one is to amend a continuing resolution that we passed by majority vote back in February of 2018, chapter C11.01, which reads, a treasurer may be hired who is not a member of the congregation. We can't legally do that per our constitution. So we want to change that to an accountant bookkeeper can be hired who is not a member of the congregation. The other change we'd like to make is the amount of money the council can authorize for items without calling a special congregation meeting. Right now, that's only $1,500. We'd like to move that to $5,000. I mean, if you had trouble with a boiler or any major thing in this church, $1,500 is not even come close to it. We'd have to wait to have a congregational meeting. So those are the two items we would like to change. And then also, we our annual meeting was scheduled to be on the third Sunday, which is the 15th of January. That, however, is the earliest it could possibly be since the 1st of January is a Sunday. That would put our annual meeting before our council meeting. We can't do that because we have to approve the budget so you can have it before. So we are moving the annual meeting to the 22nd, and we're moving our council meeting a week back to give us time to approve the agenda and or the budget, and then also get your copy the week before so we can look it over. Thank you.
Other announcements this morning? Let us rise and worship God. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you and our ears. We have our voices and all for your justice. We have neglected actions that are witness to your righteousness.
God, rejoice and be glad. God hears the prayers of all who cry out and restores us to life through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Therefore, I declare to you the forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
O God, our true life, to serve you is freedom, and to know you is unending joy. We worship you, we glorify you, we give thanks to you for your great glory. Abide with us, remain in us, and make this world into a fit habitation for your divine majesty. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated as we hear the word.
Good morning.
Good morning.
A reading from Colossians chapter 1, verses 11 through 20. An early Christian hymn praises the mystery of the political, personal, and mystical Christ, the one who is present at creation and is eternally reigning with God. May you be strong with all the strength that comes from His glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for in Him all things in heaven on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through Him and for Him. He Himself is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that He might come to have first place in everything. For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him God was pleased to reconcile to Himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of His cross. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read Psalm 46 responsibly by full verse. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore, you will not fear, though the earth be moved, and though the mountains shake in the depths of the sea.
Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city, it shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day.
The nations rage and the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Come now, regard the works of the Lord. What desolations God has brought up on the earth.
Behold the one who makes war to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire.
Be still then, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Return, O Lord, alleluia.
Then they came to the place that is called the Skull. They crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. The people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine, and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There also was an inscription over Jesus: "This is the King of the Jews." Now one of the criminals who were hanging there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is the word of the Lord. There's no right or wrong way, or no right or wrong place to preach. Many preachers will preach exclusively from the floor. Some will even walk to the end of the aisle. Other preachers will never take a step out of the pulpit. Other preachers, many Catholic priests, even preach from behind the altar. So there's no one right or wrong way. And I would be thinking this week, though, what's the point of a sermon? What are we really doing here when we read God's word and then I talk about it and have maybe a bit of a conversation with you about it? Well, to me, there's really two things that we're trying to do. One is simply proclaim the gospel, the good news. And the second is to bring God's word to bear on our lives. And so really, when you think about it, whatever place is going to do those things better, for maybe a preacher or for a congregation, well, maybe that's where I would choose to preach from. So in this space, and in this, I mean literally this space, I usually choose to preach from here. Preach from here because, well, one, there's a little less distance between us, the congregation, and the word. And two, there's less distance this way, too. The John Calvin pulpits began to take their shape in the Protestant church with John Calvin, who began to make pulpits higher and higher, and even would have, the Presbyterian Church is a good example of this, would have a railing around them. So that it would almost be like the preacher would be like a talking head. All you could see was their head. You couldn't see the rest of their body. And the idea was that sermons were supposed to be this kind of disembodied ideas talk, where we would use our heads primarily to think about God. And that's good. There's good in that. I think, though, that was good for 500 years ago, and that's good in some spaces. The trouble comes is that's not how we really live our lives. really live just in our heads. We don't live walking around just floating heads, talking to each other, just thinking. We live an embodied experience. And so I believe that preaching should be embodied too. I was taught that preaching, if you only look at what a preacher does, and you never hear a single thing, like if you were to listen on mute or take your hearing aids out for a week, you should be able to get some sense of the gospel or what the sermon was about just by what the preacher does. That doesn't mean it's like a, I don't know, what are the old-timey like comedy people that would, you know, listen like this. We don't necessarily do that. But we do preach in a way that's embodied. So there's no one right way. And I'll probably go back there sometime. But, what I think is that in this space, and with you, I'm partly here to bring an embodied word and an embodied gospel. And I think I can do that better most weeks from here, here, or here, than from back here. Now we can have that conversation. So, with that in mind, I've got a question for you. Have you ever wondered or wished why God doesn't simply make bad people good? Have you ever wondered that maybe driving somewhere on the highway and somebody cuts you off? Have you ever wished that God could just snap God's fingers and bring bad people to good, bring change hearts and change minds just like that? Well, Alex and I yesterday were having this conversation about why Jesus did what he did. And we got to thinking, well, why did the bad people, why did the rulers, the Romans and the religious authorities, why did they want to put Jesus to death if he was good? So we got thinking a little further, and Alex asked what I think is a really good question. He asked it in maybe a bit different way than I would have. He said, well, if Jesus is powerful and Jesus is good, why didn't Jesus become president? We've been talking about civics a lot recently. And, you know, actually, this question is pretty similar to one I think the disciples were wondering. See, the disciples were kind of thinking that Jesus would go to lead a revolution and become the king of Israel and restore them to their rightful place in power and glory. So I think the disciples were thinking, yeah, Jesus should be president. He should be the king of Israel and maybe even the emperor of Rome. That would be pretty good, wouldn't it? Sometimes we wonder that ourselves, too. Wouldn't it be wonderful if our rulers could simply be controlled like a puppet, by God? Well, I think there's two reasons, well, at least two reasons, that God doesn't do this. And one comes, got me thinking about this from a movie a confirmation students watched in the past few weeks. It's called The Shack. And I think it's way better than most Christian movies. The Shack is kind of a conversation between one person and God, or the three persons of God as represented by different people along this man's journey in The Shack. And at one point, Mac, the main character, tries to leave The Shack. And he starts walking away, and then he turns around and looks at God and says, aren't you going to stop me? This is where you want me, right? You want me to be here with you in the shack. And God replies to this man, I don't want slaves. I'm not interested in you being here beside your will, outside of your will. God's not interested in slaves. That's number one. Number two, though, goes maybe a little bit deeper. And that is that a God who controls us like puppets, or who somehow makes the world as exactly as we would want it to be, or even as God would want it to be, that's simply not the God that we know. That's simply not the God that is revealed in Christ, that is revealed in God's Word. Yesterday, we got back from a whirlwind, I would say, 18 hours at the All Youth Gathering. We left here with six of our young people at 4 o'clock yesterday. We stayed up till 1 a.m. at Craven's doing all kinds of things. Got up for breakfast at 7:30, and then we're back here by 3 o'clock yesterday. A bit of a whirlwind. Well, this event included speakers and activities and songs. Well, what I heard from the youth is that the most impactful thing for them, it wasn't the really talented and powerful speaker who was brought in specifically for this event. And it wasn't the bishop who was maybe the highest leader we had in our synod. And it wasn't even the music, which was really well done and powerful. No, the most powerful thing for them, the most impactful thing, was when a 16-year-old girl told them a story of experiencing anxiety in seventh grade. And then responding to that in her community of faith. And even having to find another church, another community of faith that would love her and care for her. It was that story, not of power and strength, but actually of weakness that impacted them the most. You see, God's power, God's worship is not made perfect in glory and might and majesty. God's power is instead, as Paul tells us, made perfect in weakness. God's ultimate act of power is not to change things or to show God's might. God's ultimate act of power was to give it up. To give up God's power on the cross. I'm going to read a couple verses from our text this morning. I want you to listen for where the word king shows up. The soldiers also mocked Jesus, coming up and offering him some sour wine and saying, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There also was an inscription over him, "This is the king of the Jews." Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." But one of the criminals who were hanged there derided him, saying, "Aren't you the king? Save yourself." But the other criminal rebuked him, saying, "Don't you fear God, since you are under this same sentence of condemnation? We indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he turned and looked at Jesus and said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." By my count, I've got 4. And 3 of these instances are people who are absolutely mocking Jesus. They use the word king in derision to shame and rip Jesus away from any dignity that he had left. And yet, the one person who gets it is the one who is with Jesus there and who repents and pleads to Jesus, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." This kingdom of God, this kingdom of glory and might, is found not in majesty, but on the cross. This kingdom of God, of glory and majesty, is found not in great power, but in great weakness. The kingdom of God comes to us in the gospel of good news. But it's a gospel of love, not a gospel of coercion. Yesterday, our theme for that 18-hour whirlwind was these four little things. And we talked a little bit about what the gospel means for us, for you as a seventh grader who might be experiencing some anxiety, or as a 12th grader who might be thinking about college or work pretty soon. And we said it was something like this. The gospel is that you belong, you matter, you are loved, and you are not alone. So for our text today, you belong. You belong because this God will hold on to you no matter what. Because God would rather go to the cross than be apart from you. You matter. You matter because God gave this gift, this body and blood, for you and for all people. You are loved. You are loved because God's kingdom, God's kingship, God's glory is not about majesty or power. It's about service and weakness. And you are not alone and will never be alone, because 3 days later, 3 days after that, came something different. 3 days later, God defeated the power of death so that we can never be alone, even in and through and on the other side of death. This body and blood is given and shed for you, and so too is Christ's resurrection. Thanks be to God in Christ Jesus our Lord for this gift of love and this gift. Confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Saints across every time and place, let us pray to God for our share of the world. Let us pray. God of love, we pray for your church. Embolden churches and faith-based organizations across the world in loving our neighbors and working together for the sake of your gospel. Lord, in your mercy,
we receive our prayer.
God of creation, we pray for your earth. Protect waterways and trees and forests and oceans. Help us to care for our creation as hunters and as farmers and as citizens of this country. Lord, in your mercy.
We receive our prayer.
God of the nations, we pray for all the nations of the world. Instill in every leader's heart the desire for justice and peace. Support the work of all who serve and care and love. Lord, in your mercy.
Receive our prayer.
We pray for all who are undermined or oppressed this day, O God. Amplify the voices of those unheard. Bring about righteousness and justice, and fill us all with your you thanks for all who have died in the faith. Console those who mourn and comfort us with the beautiful promise of life together with you in your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
receive our prayer.
Accept these prayers, gracious God, and those prayers known only to you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
As we pass the peace, remember, you may pass the peace with a hug, with a handshake, or however you are comfortable. May the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share with one another the peace of Christ.
Good morning. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Receiving a piece of gluten-free bread and then taking a cup on either side. The purple is wine, the white is grape juice, and you can return the cup to the holder on your side. If you'd like to commune from your seats, there are cups in the back, or you can give me a wave that will bring it to you if you prefer not to come. You can say, oh yeah, all are welcome at this table. It's important too. All are welcome at this table because this table does not belong only to us. It belongs to the Lord, and what the Lord asks of us is to have a heart that requires God, that seeks God, nothing less. So come knowing that you are welcome here, welcome at the Lord's table. On the night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, take this and eat it. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, Jesus took a cup. He gave thanks for it and gave it to them, saying, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation.
rise as you are able. And let us pray. We give you thanks, most gracious God, that you have fed us with the bread of heaven and given us a foretaste of paradise, enlightening us to be your body in the world and to serve those who are in need through Jesus Christ our Lord. People of God, receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.
Blessing.